for being here this evening, both those of you here joining us live and those who may be watching online. It is such a delight to be able to perform again in front of a live audience. It's been a number of years for a variety of reasons since I've given a recital, and I'm just blessed and privileged to be here this evening, especially sharing the stage with my wonderful colleague, Lynn Compass. When I first started putting this program together, I started with the first piece on the program, Chanson d'amour by Amy Beach, because in the 18 years I've known my husband, it's one of his most favorite pieces that I have performed, and I've been very careful not to practice it at home when he's been there, so hopefully it was a surprise this evening. I entertained several different themes for this program, and I kept coming back to songs with texts revolving, sometimes loosely, around love. And I thought, after the 2.5 years that we've all experienced, what better theme for a recital than the theme of love? I would like to dedicate this program this evening to those who have taught me most about love this side of heaven: my parents, my husband, and my two children. The first pieces on the program were by Amy Beach, an American composer and very accomplished pianist. She wrote about 150 art songs. She is known as the first female composer to have a work performed by a major symphony. Her Gaelic Symphony was performed by the Boston Symphony in 1896. This next group of pieces is by another American pianist and composer, John Duke. Duke was born in Maryland and studied at the Peabody Conservatory. He went on to have an over 40-year career on the faculty of Smith College in Massachusetts. He, although was a pianist, he primarily wrote art songs and left us with about 260 art songs, many of which harken back to the 19th century German Lied. I think you will hear that particularly in the first piece in this set, although you will also hear he composed in a variety of styles as well. I hope you enjoy this set of songs by John Duke.
Here in this spot with love.
Decided to move back to Spain and really to be proponents
makes Spanish culture vibrant through its music. Tarina is known for writing operas, works for orchestra, as well as many, many songs. And in these songs that we have for you tonight, there are three sonnets. So all of the poems were in sonnet form, but they very much embrace certain things that we think of as being quintessentially Spanish. There'll be times when you hear more percussive elements in the piano, representative of perhaps castanets or other percussive types of Spanish instruments. And there's time, especially in the third song, where you'll hear a very florid, ornamental passage in the voice, which is sung a cappella with nothing underneath it. It just has a very distinctive Spanish flair to it. These three songs, the outer two songs, deal with enraptured love. The first song talking about longing, how the poet wishes to be many different elements to be closer to his beloved, to be physically more intimate with his beloved. And the outer song talks about the two eyes of his beloved and all the things that they represent and things that he sees in her two eyes. But in the middle, we have a lovely little catalog song, kind of reminiscent of Barbarella's aria, in a way, from Don Giovanni, except from the female perspective. This time, it is a woman who has a whole list of conquests, and so we wind up just having a long list of names in the second song, and eventually we get to the latest conquest, who is Pablo, and poor Pablo is not going to have a good time.
Thank you.
Anunnaki.
So it's a real interesting link through the centuries that comes together in this Fête Galante. The poet Paul Verlaine was probably the one French poet who has been said almost more than anybody else. He was very popular with all of our 19th century French song composers, with Savalot by Fourier, Debussy, and countless others. Paul Verlaine was inspired by these Watteau paintings and wrote a whole collection of poetry under the title of Fête Galante. And Debussy selected six songs and created two groups of three. So we talk about Fête Galante 1 and Fête Galante 2. And Fête Galante 1 is set for, it's really written for soprano. And these songs are, you know, really just speak, is just very quintessential Paul Verlaine and representative of the symbolist style of poetry. The first song is entitled Muted, which is a very odd title to have, but it really has created this whole scenario where the light is being filtered through the trees and is creating this sort of subdued, intimate setting underneath the trees for two lovers to come together. And up in the tree, we hear a nightingale, which is sort of mirroring the despair of their love. The second song is sort of a fun frolic, which references a lot of our Commedia dell'arte characters. We have Scaramouche, Pulcinella, Dr. Bolognier, and they're all just kind of up to mischief. And that's the second song. And then the third song we have is one of many pieces by Debussy entitled Clair de Lune, which translates as Moonlight. This is not the Clair de Lune that everybody knows, which is the piano piece that we but this is a second setting of Clair de Lune that he wrote for the voice, which is very indicative of the style that he eventually settled into, his more mature writing style, which we hear represented in his one opera masterpiece, Gaius. Thank you.
was born at the very end of the 19th century in what is now known as the Czech Republic. He was a child prodigy early on, writing ballets and other things by the age of 11. At 13, Gustav Mahler proclaimed him a musical genius, so that's pretty high praise. His opera Die Todesstadt, many of you may be familiar with that work, was written when he was only 23. In the early 1930s, he immigrated to the United States, in part due to an invitation to come to Hollywood to score music for films, and also due to the Nazi occupation in Europe. He went on to become most known for his Hollywood film scores, writing the music to 16 films. This earned him 4 Academy Award nominations, and he won 2 Oscars for his work. In this work, Drei Lieder, Opus 22, I believe you will enjoy his rich harmonies and his very lush lyricism for the voice. They're a lot of fun to sing, and I hope you enjoy them. Drei Lieder of Erik Korngold.
Thank you.
Here this evening. It's been a great joy to perform for you, and we hope that we've brought you a little bit of joy this evening as well. We would like to end with three fun pieces featuring different aspects of love, desperately seeking love, defining love, and, well, I'll let you figure out the last one.
Thank you. chapter 1. Now the first way to lose a man. You've met a charming fellow and you're out for a spin. The motor fails and he just wears a helpless grin. Don't bat your eyes and say, what a romantic spot we're in. Just jump out, crawl under the car, tell him it's the gasket, and fix it in 2 seconds flat with a bobby pin. That's a good way to lose a man. He takes you to a baseball game, you sit knee to knee. He says, the next man up at bat will bunt, you'll see. Don't say, oh, what's a bunt? This game's too hard for little me. Just say, bunt, are you nuts? With one out and two men on base, he'll walk right into a double play, just like it happened in the fifth game of the World Series in 1923. That's a fine way to lose a man. A fine, 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 fine way to lose a man. A dandy way to lose a man. Just throw your knowledge in his face. He'll never try for second base. 98 ways to go. Now the third way to lose a man. The lifeguard at the beach that all the girlies adore swims bravely out to save you through the ocean's roar. Don't say, oh, thanks, I would have drowned in just 1 second more. Just push his head underwater, yell, last one in's a rotten egg, and race him back to shore. That's a good way to lose a man. You've met your perfect match, and it's been love from the start. He whispers, you're the one to whom I give my heart. Don't say, I love you too, my dear, let's never, never part. Just say, I'm afraid you've made a grammatical error. It isn't to who I give my heart, it's to whom I give my heart. You see, with the use of the preposition to, who becomes the indirect object, making the use of whom imperative, which I can easily show you by drawing a simple chart. That's a sure way to lose it.